Imagine atoms as the ultimate old friends. Everything you see around you, even the atmosphere itself, is made up of them, usually bound in molecular form. And those atoms you see around you have been there for time immemorial. They were the stuff of the dinosaurs and the early Earth. They make up the humdrum day-to-day existence of us humans throughout our own history, and indeed we ourselves are made of them. Over and over, it's a cycle. We are the chemistry of carbon, number 6 on the periodic table, among a host of other elements. Everything you have ever interacted with was made not of fossil atoms, but ancient active ones at the most basic level. They may as well be new. They are also eminently predictable, known quantities for the most part other than in certain instances, and they are very dependable. We would not be here if they were not, nor would Earth. But sometimes the behavior of old friends can change under certain stresses and conditions. We all know this, and our beautiful atoms can do this as well. We are very familiar with hydrogen, the most common element in the universe. You interact with it every day, but only in a certain form and under certain conditions. Whenever you drink a beverage, you're ingesting water, two hydrogen atoms and an atom of oxygen. All life on Earth requires that molecule. Water is the solvent of life, but intimately involves hydrogen. But water can behave differently than its familiar self. Subject it to too much heat and other factors and it flashes to a gas. Subject it to the absence of heat and it freezes solid. This also applies to the other elements. They can have melting points and other instances where their properties change. But we are familiar with the conditions of Earth, home. We can watch water boil, and we can watch silicates melt and spew from volcanoes, and we can look at the elements and molecules that make up our gaseous atmosphere. But that's not all that atoms can do. Despite the diversity of what we see, what we don't have in our day-to-day existence are the conditions needed to make atoms behave in very unfamiliar ways, sometimes almost spooky or alien ways, than our normal experience. No place shows this more prominently than on Earth's crust than it does the intense pressure of the oceans. Water, the mother chemical of life, begins to look a bit different in the extreme depths of the oceans around hydrothermal vents. There it becomes a different state of water as it seeps down into the Earth, compresses and heats, then loses density and rises again out of the black smoker vents. One of the hypotheses about the origin of life on Earth are those very oceanic vents, and they teem with life today. But water is not the only place where we encounter hydrogen. It also makes up and fuels the sun, another major factor in life, and the energy source that largely drives the surface life of Earth. But we can usually view hydrogen in our context that we have it here on Earth, a flammable gas that can be rather dangerous in the presence of high oxygen. The infamous Hindenburg disaster of 1937 is an example where a rigid zeppelin filled with hydrogen caught fire and burned disastrously. There have been many theories advanced since that accident as to just why it happened, ranging from sabotage to static electricity, but fundamentally it was because of how dangerous hydrogen is in Earth's atmosphere. It wants to react with oxygen in order to become water, the product of hydrogen burning. But that's hydrogen in Earth's extremely oxygen-rich atmosphere, which is a disequilibrium that's being created by the biosphere native to this world. In other contexts, such as the upper atmospheres of gas giants, hydrogen is just a stable constituent gas. It's also by far the most common element in the universe, forged by the Big Bang. There are entire clouds of it that pervade galaxies and provide star-forming regions. And it's simple, number 1 on the periodic table, the lightest atom. And at its most simple, just a proton and an electron as neutral hydrogen. And it tends to exist on Earth, outside of a complex molecule anyway, as a gas that escapes the atmosphere, that still likes to pair up with another hydrogen as a molecule. But the thing is, under conditions that are not quite like Earth, it can become something very unfamiliar indeed. Still hydrogen, but different, not as we know it. Elements do this. You can make oxygen a liquid with low enough temperatures, which incidentally boils, but you can actually look at it as it does that, and oddly, it's slightly magnetic and has a light blue vague tinge. That's what we breathe, but in liquid form. But hydrogen can do this too. You can get it to a liquid state at negative 423 degrees Fahrenheit, one major use being as a rocket fuel. But hydrogen has a further state, a very strange one, that of metallic hydrogen. Metallic hydrogen is a phase of the element hydrogen that actually does seem to be present in nature. It was first hypothesized by Eugene Wigner and Hillard Bell Huntington in 1935 as a form of hydrogen that at very high pressure is something like a liquid rather than a solid, but different in that it can act as an electrical conductor, much like a metal. Where this is most marked in nature is the interiors of planets like Jupiter and Saturn, but also similar exoplanets, where the pressures are so great that hydrogen can take on this phase, even at very high temperature. Hydrogen that is not a gas, but not a solid either. Hydrogen in the periodic table sits at the top of the alkali metals, but the thing is, this very simple atom doesn't usually exhibit the properties of the other alkali metals. In a way, the prediction of Wigner and Huntington was ahead of its time. They were imagining pressures unbelievably higher than that of Earth at sea level, which actually turned out to be much higher than their original estimates, that has led us to today, where the question of metallic hydrogen is basically the so-called holy grail of high-pressure physics, but also key to understanding the layers of gas giant atmospheres, almost a century after this state of hydrogen was first hypothesized. The reality is that metallic hydrogen as a whole may be a very common substance in the universe, despite how strange it is to us. But metallic is a tricky word. The element mercury is metallic, but a liquid at the temperatures normal for the surface of the Earth. Iron can be melted, for example, and we do that. That's normal metal. Rather, metallic hydrogen is different and should display some of the properties of a metal in this state, but not others. In one case, a very strange one. The first point of this strangeness is superconductivity. Room temperature superconductors have been a sort of unicorn lately. Getting superconductivity to happen at temperatures close to warm has been a problem, but not so much for cold temperatures. And if we could ever master it, there have been claims of late of room temperature superconductivity that are not verified, but the debate is still open. Then it would have very significant repercussions on our future technological development. The thing is, metallic hydrogen could be a room temperature superconductor. Proposed in 1968, Neil Ashcroft suggested that it could actually act as a superconductor at up to 17 degrees Celsius. That's a comfortably warm fall or spring day here on Earth, jacket weather at best. That's interesting to say the least, but metallic hydrogen may have further properties that might make it that much more interesting. It might also be metastable, meaning that this might be a material in the future that we can use, especially in rocketry, as a fuel. Metastable metallic hydrogen would be a highly efficient propellant for a rocket, on the order of 3 times higher than anything we're using now. But it's in a way a unicorn, because we don't have any materials available yet that could handle this sort of thing. The strength of what you use to make the parts of the rocket engine, the nozzle, etc., isn't there. So you'd have to figure out a way to dilute the metallic hydrogen down to something manageable. One possibility is alloying it with lithium, which may allow it to be easier to produce, but a process that's still very much unclear on how to do it. But a very interesting one nonetheless. Diluted metallic hydrogen could be amongst the most useful rocket fuels we've ever conceived of. But there's a ton of uncertainty with all of this because reproducing metallic hydrogen, if it indeed exists below the atmospheres of gas giants in the solar system, has been problematic with a number of claims of successes that were then called into question. The first was in 1996 when a group at Lawrence Livermore National Laboratory reported that they accidentally created metallic hydrogen. They did it at ridiculously high temperatures and only for a microsecond. They thought you really needed solid hydrogen to do it, which actually is possible. It does have a very low temperature solid phase, but they weren't working with that. In short, they thought it would be compressed, but not especially electrically conductive. But that's not entirely what they got, as it did become conductive, meaning it seemed to become metallic. What actually happened there remains an open mystery to this day. Subsequent research, however, was conducted, and they were equally weird, and very much everything being inconclusive, along with studies of doing this with deuterium, but no solid proof yet that hasn't been called into question. There was even a very high-pressure experiment done in 2016 using a diamond anvil to contain it, where hydrogen went from the normal transparent phase to black in color and then shiny and metallic as the pressure was increased. This work is basically stalled, but one of the plans was to slowly release the pressure to see if it indeed was metastable and hold its metallic state. Unfortunately, the sample was lost when the diamond anvil broke in 2017. There have been subsequent experiments and claims, including one that it was not metastable, but so far no real proof has been presented. But again, metallic hydrogen is weird. It makes up the bulk of Jupiter and Saturn in metallic form. But you'd think that would also hold true for the Sun, but it doesn't. Their hydrogen is a plasma, just a free mix of single protons and liberated electrons. Yet more hydrogen weirdness. One of the issues here is that hydrogen, when you disassociate the electrons, is just a proton. Yes, an atom, but without some of the benefits of being a larger atomic nucleus. This means that things like electrostatic repulsion don't really apply. Instead, what applies are quantum effects, such as degeneracy pressure, where you can't quite crush everything down like you normally would with matter. Jupiter and Saturn are very strange indeed. High-temperature hydrogen worlds, where hydrogen is forced to reveal its quantum nature. But if we could ever reproduce that here on Earth, and indeed it was metastable, it might rank among the most important discoveries of high-pressure physics, and open entire new avenues for technological development. Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently looking at the other elements suspiciously. Yes, gold has its uses, silver can be rather pretty when it's not oxidizing, uranium is just scary, but then there is boron. Very odd indeed, and be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.